Hello and welcome to our show. This is a visit we had at the Aquarium of the Pacific on September 6, 2003. Now here are the stars of the show. That's Melissa, Stephanie, Grandma Nelly, and me. So hope you enjoy. Bye. Now here we are lounging around in the front of the facility by the fountain. This is just prior to its opening at 9 a.m. The Aquarium of the Pacific is located in Long Beach near the ocean.
I'm going to talk to you a little bit about that in a minute. But Howard, I notice you're wearing about a 3 mil wetsuit. That wouldn't do very well in here, would it?
That's correct. I understand you're in about 65 degrees in there.
It's nice this time of year because our scientists cook this place all the way up to around 65, 66 degrees to try to replicate the temperature of the water that you would find between, say, here at Catalina Island. In the wintertime, the temperature in this exhibit will get down closer to 60 degrees to try to mimic the winter water that we have off our coast.
That's correct. I understand that the kelp here is a little bit different than the kelp you find out in the open ocean. Maybe you can tell us why that is and what's the difference.
Well, first things first, does everybody know what kelp is? Who knows what kelp is? Let's see some hands. Melissa, you know what kelp is. Okay. Kelp is this stuff. You guys know it as that smelly, fly infested stuff you find on the beach called seaweed. These are little bubbles that you like to pop with your toes. And these great big leaves are how the kelp gathers the sunlight and the nutrients from the water to make itself grow. The unique difference between the kelp that you'll find at, say, Zuba Beach and the kelp you find right here inside this blue cavern is our kelp is made out of plastic. It's bloody baloney. The reason is kelp needs a number of things to grow healthy. It needs a lot of cold water. We got 150,000 gallons of that in here. But it needs some current natural sunlight nutrients. And we don't have so much of that. And so we made our kelp out of plastic. But as you can see, the fish don't seem to mind at all.
Now, I understand the difference between, say, kelp and a plant is that kelp is not a plant. Is that right?
Kelp is an algae. Technically, the difference is plants, as you know, have roots that go into the ground and they gather moisture and nutrients from the soil. Kelp, as an algae, doesn't have roots as such. It has what we call a holdfast. It's a root-like structure that anchors into the rocks on the bottom. In our exhibit here, our holdfast is made of zip ties. The kelp, or the algae, actually gathers its nutrients and its moisture directly from the water around it. And that distinguishes it from a plant.
Now, I noticed that you guys are feeding a fish in there.
They have really sharp teeth, and they're kind of gentle and benign anyway. And they will eat the food right out of his hand. Our other divers, Gary and Tracy, are feeding the halibut. And they usually feed the halibut with tongs, because the halibut have really sharp teeth, and they don't see so good.
I see.
I'm serving hors d'oeuvres to everybody else in an effort to keep them away from Eric and Tracy and Gary.
I noticed that Eric has been very nice to create that nice bubble screen for you by being right underneath you.
Yeah, I noticed that too. Why don't I move over here?
There we go. A little diver humor there for you. Now, I noticed there's some rather large fish in there. They look to be almost fully grown and huge. Is that correct, or?
Well, a lot of the fish in here are fully grown. The very biggest are right underneath me here.
Those would be the giant sea bass?
Those are the giant sea bass, and they have a unique bit of a history in that they were hunted almost to extinction back in the 40s and 50s. When we almost lost the sea bass, the state put them on a protected list. And the same divers and fishermen who used to hunt them began to protect them. And over the years, when divers didn't see any for a while, then they began seeing one or two. Now divers are seeing larger schools of larger fish. So conservation works, guys. We want to keep it up.
Now, I understand we have another bass in there, the white sea bass. And I'd like to know, is anybody in the crowd able to point out the white sea bass? Let me give you a couple of hints for those of you who are looking. First of all, they're not white, and they're not bass.
They're not white, and they're not bass. No, indeed. They're really gray or brown croakers.
What's he feeding?
Let's swim up and talk to one, and then I see Mark out there has an audiovisual aid for us. This is a white sea bass right here. Actually, a silver croaker. Those fish also were nearly lost, but the state has been able to reproduce, or got them to produce an awful lot of them, and so now there are 7 million in the water. They are a good fish to catch and eat if you like. Although I don't know many people that like brown croaker all that much. White sea bass is a little more popular. maybe that's what the name is. Maybe that's why they named it. If you guys turn around and look behind you, you'll see that Mark is holding up an audiovisual aid. This is 7 feet of giant sea bass. To finish our giant sea bass story, the giant sea bass will camp right underneath me. They're youngsters. They're only a couple of 100 pounds, probably. They will grow to be as big as 450 to 500 pounds and live as long as 75 years. They'll be as big as that egg that they're showing. They'll probably be just a little heavier looking than that. They will have to live that long. And we're trying very hard in our aquarium to raise some giant sea bass. The way we're doing it is we're very fortunate. We have this male and female couple of fish, and they're in love. And every now and then they give us a chance by raising four or five million. They spawn, and they give us 4 or 5 million chances to raise some sea bass. And what we do is we gather the results of that spawning, and up above where you can't see, up above on the third floor, there are some containers up there that our scientists use to put the juveniles and try to raise them to thrive.
That's correct. In fact, if you were to embrace, look at all.
Nobody's feeling poorly. Keep an eye on the fish, for example, my sharp deputy here. Keep an eye on the fish. Because we don't want any of these. We want our fish to be right side up. And so if we see one kind of tipped over, we'll let our scientists know. They'll pull them out of the exhibit, put them in the fish hospital, pick them up and throw them back in to get them back to work.
Well, let me ask you one last question. What fish in this exhibit would you say is your favorite and why?
Well, my favorite in this exhibit is really the little
bat ray. That one's dying.
Probably nowhere where you can see it right now.
That's a flounder.
What I love about it is even though it isn't her turn to be fed all the time,
it's okay. It's supposed to be on its side.
I feel like in Finding Nemo, remember? Bob's garden. And he got one of his eyes on his side.
But she usually gets a little extra snack that way. I admire her her dedication and her love.
There she is. She's coming up right here to your lower left. One of the nice things about the pelagic ray that he's mentioned is if you were to go snorkeling or scuba diving off of Catalina, you would see everything right here in the shallow water, with the exception of the pelagic ray. She is more of an open ocean. Those of you who are snorkeling probably would not see her, whereas the divers kind of get the unique experience and the possibility of seeing her. Well, Andy, what I wanted to do is thank you very much for coming today.
Well, thank you for being out there. Talking to us. Thank you everybody for coming to the Aquarium, spending a little bit of a nice weekend with us. We're always happy to see you. We hope you have a safe and happy weekend with your family and friends. If your kids happen to drink a high five, you'll be one of those right down there at the bottom. Otherwise, have a great day at the Aquarium and a great weekend. Thanks a lot.
And for those of you who'd like to see a feeding of fish again at 10:30 in Tropical, we have another presentation with divers and feeding. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
And of course, no trip to the aquarium would be complete without a visit to the dead otter exhibit. I hope you enjoy this thing. We watched it for a long time and the thing never moved. And if you look carefully here, I spotted this gorgeous babe out in the crowd. She was way down there and I had to zoom way in. But look at that. See how far I'm zoomed out? It's pretty crowded there. I'm lucky to have found her in such a crowd. Anyways, looks like she bought something. Wonder what that could be. Maybe it's the picture that's on the stars of the show at the beginning of the flick. Uh-oh, I think she spotted me. I better lay low. I don't want to get busted. Oh dear. Uh-oh, I think she's coming up.
Way too close.
Well,